if you want to improve your Python and be able to develop good programs, you need to understand the basics of data structures like graphs and trees. These are used in a wide area of computer science, such as when we're learning about networks and artificial intelligence. Let's have a look at graphs. A graph is a non-linear data structure consisting of vertices and edges. I tend to use the word node, so nodes and edges. So here we can see we have nodes and edges, which are lines that connect the nodes. So an edge basically connects two nodes. We can think of this as a type of structure, an abstract model, which we can use both to model areas such as networks in real life and also to store data. Normally we use circles to represent the nodes. This is an example of an undirected graph. If we want a directed graph, instead of lines we use arrows so we know which direction we're going in. We can also use weights. So this is a weighted undirected graph. And this is a weighted directed graph. Now we can store data in the nodes, and we can also have weights of the links. So the edges really represent the relationship between two data items. So these could be objects, for example. In this example, D is a neighbour of A, and there's 5 units between them. It could be a cost or a distance, it's some type of figure. A is a neighbour of B, 3 units between them. C is a neighbour of B, and there are 8 units between them. In a directed graph, we can see that D is a neighbour of A, and there's 5 units to get from A to D. Or if we want to go from B to A, there's 3 units. Or from B to C, there's 8 units. Now, this is directed, so we may not be able to get from D to A, or from A to B, or to C to B. That's the point of it being directed. So with a graph, if we need to go through each element or through the graph, we can say we traverse the graph. So we can select, we can identify, we can even print each node. Other operations we can insert, we can update and delete. We tend to update and insert and delete nodes, and then we have to update the edges that the graph needs to continue to be a graph. So for example here, if we deleted the node A, then we still need some type of link from B to D. So maybe we would connect B directly to D with a directed arrow, and that would have a cost. You could see here on the left we've got a graph, but the arrow from C's point to A and B can go in any direction. We can call that a directed acyclic graph because it's not going in a circular direction. As opposed to the graph on the right, we can see A to C to B to A. This is a circular form, so it's a cyclic graph. So directed graphs are used in things like Google's page ranking algorithm. Trees are also a form of a graph. Let's have a brief introduction to trees. Tree is also a non-linear data structure with nodes and edges. Here we have edges from a parent node to children nodes. It's also a structure, it's also an abstract model, and it's also a way we can store data. It's a data structure. Now, a tree can be used for many different tasks, and whatever task you're using for will determine what type of tree you're going to use. So we don't necessarily have one tree that fits all. We have the structure of the tree, and then we can apply it in different ways. It's a hierarchy, the same like a family tree or an organizational chart. But how you use it, such as in Python, will determine what code you use. So we don't really have the tree code and use that for everything. We actually have different forms of code that structurally are trees. but they apply the logic we can use when using a tree to different tasks. So for example, if we just want to like model a different structure, we could use a simple dictionary. Now, the key needs to be unique, so that would be the child, and the value would be the parent. So in this example, we can see that we've used a dictionary to model the tree that you can see on the right. Now, would you use a dictionary when you implement a tree? Well, again, that depends on what task you wanted it for. Primarily, Python, we use classes when we implement a tree. So we may, for example, have a class tree, and then we can think of what's on the left and what's on the right, and also what data we have. Again, we traverse the tree, we can insert, update, and delete, and again, we have to think about edges. So if we deleted B, would we have an edge from A to D, for example? Now in computer science, we often use binary trees to learn how we can insert and delete, keep order with, etc. So binary trees are often used in data structures and algorithms to learn how we can implement code on a tree. Now a binary tree will have 0, 1 or 2 children nodes, hence the idea of binary. And again, what we can do, we have basic operations, inserting, removing, searching, traversing. Also, we may find when we're inserting nodes that our tree gets unbalanced, which is not very efficient for searching. So maybe we need to change our tree so it's more balanced and better for a searching algorithm, for example. And we can use different modules such as binary tree, which is in Python. Other modules involving trees, we can have tree lib, any tree, tiny tree. We can also use a default dictionary from collections, but generally we're going to use classes. So we have class node and class tree. So objects are often the approach we have for implementing a tree. Specific areas we might see trees in: the model, abstract data model of a XML document is a tree, and in language processing, we use it for different types of language representation. So, for example, an abstract syntax tree. Many different areas. Here's an example, you know, deep mind, we do deep learning. So we can use trees and graphs in many, many areas of computer science. Many areas of computer science, what examples are there? Well, for example, in networks, we can use trees and graphs. So when a packet comes into a local area network, we might need to broadcast a message to each node. Now that would saturate the whole network, because if one node is connected to all the rest, that will send the message, and the next node is connected to the rest, that would duplicate that message, and it will be duplicated by all the nodes. So when we want to broadcast, we want to know just which nodes we need to visit just once and how we're going to do that. So we can use a spanning tree to work out the best path to get to each node when we want to broadcast. So that's an example of using spanning tree in networks. We can also use graphs in networks. So how do we route packets around the internet? Well, we use routing algorithms. And we use graphs. How do we connect peers in peer-to-peer? We again use graphs. So we use graph extraction to calculate how we can do something. So here's an example. Here we've got a graph, we've got nodes, which are routers in real life, and edges, which are links. So we can model a network. And here we can say that each edge has a cost. It could be a length of time for a packet, it could be some type of distance, etc. And technically we have a graph, which is nodes and edges, and our nodes, which are our routers, are U, V, W, X, Y, and Z, and then we have our links between them. So we can use a graph abstraction to calculate what we want to do with our network in real life. So how might we find the shortest path or cost from, let's say, from U to Z? Well, there's different algorithms. So here's an example of the Bellman Ford. And here we've got from U to its neighbours, its three neighbours, V, W and X, and they have a cost of 2, 1 and 3. Now from those neighbours to our destination, we have costs of 5, 3 and 3. So to work out the shortest path, we can add them up, and the shortest path is via X, which is a distance of 4, which you can see here, U, X, Y and then Z. Another method would be Dijkstra's algorithm. So here we go through steps. So we're looking from U, so we go to a neighbour, we've got X, so we can go to X in the shortest route of 1. Then what else we can go? We can go to Y, and we can get to Y in 2. Then we can go to V. V we can get in 2 as well. Now we can get to W. The shortest route from W is via Y, which is a cost of 4. And if we get to Z, we've also got a cost of 4 through Y. So that's our shortest path, or our lowest cost path. That's using the Dijkstra's algorithm. So you can see here, for example, if we want to create a forwarding table from which node or router in networks, how we can decide where to go from one destination to another using the shortest path. And in Python code, we wouldn't really need to calculate how to do this code ourselves. We can go online and get the code and then use the example. So on most of these examples of data structures and algorithms, we already have the code. So what we need to do is we need to understand the abstract model, and then we need to understand how we can apply it on our problem to reach our solution. So the Python coding is not difficult because we have the code already. It's how we apply our design that improves our coding, because we understand the abstract model and how we can use that model for our specific situation. What is the problem and how we can apply it to find the solution. Okay, well, if you like that, please give us a thumbs up, and if you haven't already, subscribe.